with you, and I know this isn't going to sound very good at this moment. Right now, I don't want to know her name. But I hope at some point, you know, 8 or 9 years down the road, I'll get to meet her. I would love that.
I hope you get to meet her, too. The report says that she was underwater for an estimated, I think, 8 to 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Before you guys got there.
Right.
That's a long time.
It is.
Weather.
It is. And
underwater.
You know, my corporal, he's been promoted since then, but my corporal, he's probably one of the best guys I ever trained. Probably one of the best guys I've ever worked with. And I, one of the things that him and I did talk about when we got back to the police department after everything was over with, you know, he said the baby's body temperature was measured at 86.7 degrees, I believe. I know it was either 86.7 or 87.6. Either way, it's extremely low. I'm not taking anything away from my corporal or myself in any means, but I'm telling you, if that child's body temperature wasn't what it was, we would never have been able to save her. So we were just an after effect. Her organs slowing down the way they did because of her body temperature is a big part of what saved that child's life. Definitely. Yeah.
Damn, man. That's some heavy shit.
Yeah. But,
is there anything else that happened on scene that you want to talk about?
On scene? No, you know, just, I've had to tell the story a couple times, but I knew it from a very far distance, if that makes sense to you.
Yeah.
So the closer I get to the story, the tougher it is to tell. But it just, on scene, you know, the memory of the guy pulling up and asking to help, you know, that's just the way those people are around that city. And the support that the citizens gave me afterwards was a big reflection of that too. But back to the story, what happened was when I entered into the police department parking lot, when you enter the building, there was an outer door that you go into, and then you're in a little foyer area. You've got two different doors you can go through. There's one that goes, if you go straight through, that door takes you down a hallway, goes to our squad room, evidence room, my office, another office. If you take an immediate left and go through that door, straight into my lieutenant's office, which is where the suspect was. So the only way to get into either one of those doors is with a 4-digit code. As by policy, those doors have to be shut, which that code's always activated no matter what when they're shut. When I got out of my police car, ran through the parking lot, I remember grabbing that door to the outer foyer, the public entrance. I yanked it open, entered that foyer. I don't remember ever putting a code in. I don't remember opening a door. The next memory that I've got is me being basically punched, kicked, choked, yelled at, screamed at by my lieutenant and other officers trying to get me off the guy. I remember seeing the guy on the floor underneath me, and it was very easy for me to figure out what I did. That kind of a picture, you don't mistake what you just did to somebody, and I didn't. I immediately called my my city clerk. Great woman. She heard some of the ruckus from City Hall. They're connected to the police department. And she came over and was screaming, wanting to know what's going on. Is everybody okay? And I said, yeah, it's okay. I was in a pretty bad state at that point, and I just said, I resigned. I quit. She said, no, we're not going to let you. And I shut myself in my office and stayed in there for about 20 minutes, trying to get myself calmed down, and then called my mayor, Levi Weaver, good man. I told him I was going to resign. I said, I resign, I quit. I resigned my post, and he didn't know what had happened. He had zero idea. And he said, Chief, no, never. And he wouldn't let me. So that's kind of people I was with. So that was big.